We return our tithes and our offerings, dear God. We pray that you will use this for the furtherance of your gospel. And all of this, dear Lord, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
God bless you as you give this morning. Thank you very much for coming. Beautiful choir, amen. I would like to ask now the teachers. Teachers, I want you to understand, this Sunday is dedicated to you. We want to recognize you and to honor you for being our heroes in the classroom. You have taught our children, you have spent all the time. Some of you were praying for the children, and we are really grateful that you are here today. I want you to understand that Bible Baptists appreciate your work and your labor in the classroom. So this morning, I would like to ask the teachers, okay? Atong yun mga teachers dire dapit, Tindog, mga teachers, please line up over here. Ushers, palihog, tabang diri. Tabang diri. Ushers, Brother Valdez. Dali, tanang teachers, palihog diri. Linya. Linya, palihog. Linya, mga teachers. Linya diri, mga teachers. Kanang dihan lang. Kumana. Dali, dali, dali. Dali, mga teachers. Mga teachers. Ah, pwede tingnan diri sa kini diri, mga teachers diri. Come on, let's go. Dali. Dali, dali. Mga teachers, ayaw mo kaulaw kay this Sunday is for you. We want you to feel honored. Linya, ayaw usag tagay. Ayaw usag tagay. Oh, mga guwapo mga teachers, oy. Grabe. Oh, dali, dali. Dali. Mga teachers. Okay? Okay. All right, panagay na to gift, please, everybody. Give them a gift. We have a gift for the teacher. We have a gift. Salamat. Salamat. Kining mga teachers na to, dunay niwang, dunay gamay-gamay, nga dunay mas dako-dako. Ayaw na natambok, basta naay dako-dako. Oh. Okay. Ikaw dai, wa ka no? Wala. Brother Valdez, tagay ni, tagay, tagay. Oh. Okay. Okay. Tagay, tagay, tagay. Puting hinaya na sa doy. Ang puting nga nung hinaya mo mo, quickly, 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 let's go. Let's go. Oh, nitabang na si Teresa. Natay ba kong asir? Oh. Okay, give a big hand, give a big hand, big hand, big hand, balik, sagi. Anybody else, teachers, teachers, tindog, diri, diha, napa diha, napa yung teachers, diri, dali, brother, brother, brother Joy, dali, dali, brad, hindi, brad, palinya ha, diri, palinya, ayaw na, kuna, ayaw na, tagay, alaw tagay, napa diri, napa o. Oh, dali brad. Any more teachers? Any more? Balgunahi. Dali. Yes. Right there. Wait for them. Wait for them. Wait for them. Mezzanine. Mezzanine. Nadia. Ha? Unsa ka mo? Teachers o tudloanan? Amen. Praise the Lord. Linya, 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 linya. Wana? Albut ka linya, no? Tagay na rin, no? Give a big hand, give a big hand. Napa'y coming. Napa? Tiyan mo? Kini nga itong mga teachers, one, mura nagbitoon. Oh, dili, dili ma-appear kung may dagom. Okay, thank God, teachers. I want you to know you are special this morning. Amen? Praise the Lord. Thank you very much. Okay, before the message, we have a special number. Oh, thank you. We have a special number. Brother Zamora, Sunday, right here, brother, right here. Right here. Oh.
The day when the world was so much younger, there came just a promised man, so the Son of God can walk among the people to see him live and die and live again. But God's love the world back then is not a secret, but there's something now everyone should know. God still loves the world. God still loves the world. What the cross had to say is still saying today. God still loves the world.
Amen.
God loved the world when Jesus blessed the children, and when his touch became the blind man's eyes to see. On the ancient afternoon, they crucified him. His love became the greatest fact in history. But God loved the world back then is not a secret, but there's something now everyone should know. God still loves the world.
Amen. Praise the Lord.
God still loves the world. What the cross had to say is still saying today. God still loves the world. God still loves the world. God still loves the world. What the cross had to say is still saying today. God still loves the world. What the cross had to say is still saying today. God still loves the world.
Brad, nindot kayong kanano. Yay! Basta lang. Huwag kang may pangtiyan, ani. Maglisod. Salamat. Our speaker today is not new to us. He has been here every year. Dr. Batem has been here every year, and my, what a beautiful, beautiful opportunity to have them. Every time he comes to shade this stage, it makes me feel very young. Because I tell you, I have seen him a long, long time ago in his church, in Central Baptist Church in Pomona, California. And Dr. Batema is the staff evangelist and chairman of the board, United Community Church in Glendale, California. Folks, I want you to welcome Dr. Batem big hand as he comes today and preach for us.
Thank you. Thank you, Doc.
There you go.
All right. Fasten your seatbelt. I'm the pilot. What a joy it is to be back again in Cebu. I love the Philippines, and every Saturday night in our home in Las Vegas, we watch the service on the internet, And so I am hoping, and probably I'm quite sure, that my wife and my son Ryan are watching. And so I want to welcome them to the service. But we watched last Sunday, the Sunday morning service. How many of you were here last Sunday morning? Would you raise your hand? Pastor Kent preached a message on the family. And I told my wife as we were watching it, I said to her, that is just about the best message I have ever heard on the family. Hey, do you realize how fortunate you are to be a part of a church with a father and son duo like you have? I listened to the message, and then I heard that passionate, crying invitation. And I said to myself, if I lived within driving distance of this church, this is where I would want to raise my children, okay? I want to speak to you this morning for a few moments on Jesus, the man who was God. Jesus, the man who was God. Would you stand with me together, if you would, everyone standing? And I'm going to ask you to turn in your Bibles to the book of Hebrews. And in just a few moments, I'm going to read the scripture from Hebrews. Before I do that, I want us to do something together this morning. Before I read the scripture, I do not believe that God has sent me here on about a 10,000 mile round trip from where I live to here. I don't believe God has allowed me to come to the Philippines just to preach a couple of messages. I really believe that God wants to do something special in our hearts this morning. This is serious stuff. I thought about the teachers. God bless you, school teachers. We used to have an old saying that went something like this: the hand that rocks the cradle rules the world. The hand that rocks the cradle rules the world. And so you teachers, what a tremendous responsibility you have, because 10 or 15 years from now, your students are going to be running this country. That's what's scary, and I look at what's happening in my country. The colleges fell a long time ago. And so the public schools hire their teachers from the colleges. And so we have a mess going on. They call themselves millennials. And they think that socialism and communism is just really cool. They think it's fantastic. So you teachers, you have a tremendous responsibility. I want us to pray together in a moment, but before we do that, on the count of three, I'm going to ask you, and we'll do it all together, to take a deep breath, the deepest breath that you can take, and then I want you to hold it there, only for a few seconds, okay? Now, this is something we do 15,000 times, around 15,000 times a day, okay? We breathe. So on the count of three, we're going to breathe in together. Are you ready? One, two, three. I want to remind you, you did not do that by yourself. God allowed you and me to take that breath. And God knows, and only God knows, that when you and I take our last breath on this earth, we will take our first breath in eternity. Either heaven or hell. And if you're here this morning and you're not sure that it's heaven, you came to the right church, because we're going to give you an opportunity at the close of this service to accept Jesus Christ as your personal Savior. Jesus, the man who is God. Look in your Bible, if you would, at Hebrews chapter 2. Before we pray, I want us to read my main text, okay? The main scripture, Jesus, the man who was God. In Hebrews chapter number 2 and verse 14, I want you to follow in your Bible as I read, because I want to tell you something, folks. These are some of the greatest verses in the Bible. Read them and think about them. Verse 14. For as much then as the children are partakers of flesh and blood, he also himself likewise took part of the same, that through death he might destroy him that had the power of death, that is, the devil, and deliver them who through fear of death were all their lifetime subject to bondage. For verily, he took not on him the nature of angels, but he took on him the seed of Abraham. Wherefore, in all things, underline that when you have time in your Bible, in all things, it behooved him to be made like unto his brethren. That's talking about Jesus. That he might be a merciful and faithful high priest in things pertaining to God, to make reconciliation for the sins of the people. For in that he himself hath suffered being tempted, he is able to succor them that are tempted. Shall we pray together? Our Heavenly Father, take these verses and these next few moments to speak to our hearts. We thank you for your awesome power. We thank you, Jesus, that whatever needs are represented in this service this morning, that every need can and will be met by the Lord Jesus Christ. We ask it in Jesus' name, for Jesus' sake. Amen. You may be seated. My assignment this morning, if you're a teacher, you give assignments. My assignment this morning is very simple. Before you walk out of the doors of this church, I want you to remind yourself that nothing is impossible with God. I wonder how many of you, I'm going to speak to the choir for just a moment. How many of you in the choir grew up in a Christian home? Could I see your hand? You grew up in church and you grew up in a Christian home. Anybody in the choir? Okay, up here. I want you to think for just a moment. I can remember growing up in a good church, the Wealthy Street Baptist Church in Grand Rapids, Michigan. And I remember the Bible stories as a child. Somebody in the choir, tell me, when you were growing up, what was your favorite Bible study? Did any of you have a favorite? Anybody? Tell me, favorite Bible study? How about Noah and the ark? How about when Jesus fed the 5,000 with a little boy's lunch? Think of the miracle of that. The miracle was the little boy hadn't already eaten the lunch. When my mother used to make lunch for me and I'd go to school, I would eat my lunch on the way to school in the morning, okay? But just think about these great miracles. Jonah and the whale. I can remember as a boy leaving Sunday school, as a little boy, saying to myself, oh, what an awesome, powerful God we have. And those stories were so alive and they were so real. And in my heart, it made me have this tremendous appreciation for this awesome God we serve. But then we get older and they're just Bible stories, right? They're not as awesome as they were when we were little children growing up. And so this morning, a very simple message about Jesus. I don't want you to lose that awesomeness of Jesus, of knowing Him. See, the Apostle Paul warned the church in Corinth. I don't have time. This is my warm-up. I'm going to get to my message in a moment. But the Apostle Paul in 2 Corinthians chapter number 11 and verse 3, and you can turn to it some other time. The Apostle Paul warned the church at Corinth about another Jesus. He warned them about a counterfeit Jesus. And so today, we have many churches that are preaching a fake Jesus. Did you know that? It's not the Jesus of the Bible. It's a fake Jesus. Thank God the church that you're in this morning, this church, does not preach a fake Jesus. We don't preach a counterfeit Jesus. You say, well, Brother Bateman, what do you mean by a fake Jesus? A fake Jesus would be a Jesus that puts his approval on same-sex marriage. That's a fake Jesus. A fake Jesus would be a Jesus that approves of the LGBT lifestyle. That would be a fake Jesus. A fake Jesus would be a Jesus that is nothing more than a fire escape. You can accept Jesus and then continue to live the same way you've always lived. A fake Jesus is a Jesus that doesn't change your life. Fake Jesuses. There's so many churches now that are preaching a fake Jesus, a counterfeit Jesus, a Jesus that is not real. I have a fake watch. This is a counterfeit watch. I bought it here in the Philippines. It's a Breitling watch, and it has Las Vegas time right now. It's 7:35 on Saturday night in Las Vegas. But I bought this watch because it's a Breitling, okay? And a Breitling watch, I've always loved Breitling watches. A real Breitling watch cost $5,000. Okay, that's why I got the fake one, okay? I can't afford a real one, okay? It's okay to have a counterfeit watch, but make sure you don't have a counterfeit Jesus. And so this morning, I'm going to talk to you about the real Jesus. The real Jesus of the Bible. I began studying this subject. Jesus was so many things. He was a teacher. So you teachers have chosen a good profession because Jesus was also a teacher. He was a preacher. He was a doctor. He was the great physician. All of these things. He was a son. He was a brother. All of these things were wrapped up in Jesus. And each one of them by themselves is a message all by itself. But this morning, I want you to think with me for just a few moments about Jesus, the man. Jesus, the human. Not a fake Jesus. Not a Jesus that has been corrupted by man's philosophy and man's thinking. I have been studying Jesus for 60 years. And I was thinking about this the other day when I preached this message. I had never, until just a few weeks ago, preached an entire message about the humanity of Jesus. He was a human being like you and I. And I really believe that Jesus was much more like us than we really realize. Jesus, the man who was God. He was all these things, a teacher, a builder, a son. But he was a man who was God. For 33 and a half homesick years, Jesus was on this earth. He was God. He was not 50% God and 50% man. Jesus was 100% God and 100% man at the same time. The divinity of Christ. Now you say, Brother Bateman, why is that such a big deal? It is a big deal. The very fact that Jesus can identify with you and I. He can identify with us because he was a man. You know, I'm sure maybe Jesus, think about this for a moment, maybe he was a toddler in the nursery, in the synagogue. I wonder if Mary had to potty train Jesus. We had to potty train all our kids. And I can just see Mary potty training Jesus. He was a baby. We don't know very much about Jesus' life, actually, until he was 12 years of age. The Bible is silent about his life. Think about when the baby teeth came in. And then he became a teenager. And his voice began to change. He started to grow a beard. Our son Ryan has a little beard growing, okay? Jesus started to grow a little beard, okay? He was a man. Jesus, the man who was God, he began to work in his father's carpenter shop. Jesus was a carpenter. You know, when we think of Jesus, we most of the time, if I were to ask you, what does Jesus look like? Our mind goes to that famous picture of Jesus with the long hair and the beard and the kind of effeminate look. I do not think pictures like that are, I don't think it's sinful to have a picture like that as long as you're not worshiping it, okay? But neither do I think that Jesus looked like that. Maybe the Jesus I'm thinking about wore a t-shirt and a pair of Levi's and a carpenter's tool belt. See, carpenters today and carpenters back then were different. Today, carpenters have skill saws and electric hammers, you know. Jesus had none of that. When Jesus built a porch or a house, he did it all by hand. I bet he had some pretty good biceps, don't you? He worked. The man who was God. The Bible says in our scripture that we read a moment ago, Jesus was tempted. He was tempted, the Bible says, as we are, yet without sin. How many of you have ever been tempted to do something wrong? Could I see your hand? Put your hand up. You have been tempted. You have been tempted. You better raise your hand or you'll be lying. We have all been tempted. Jesus was tempted. And we can say to Jesus, Jesus, were you tempted? He would have to say yes. Jesus was tempted. So as you go through your temptations, just remind yourself that Jesus also was tempted. These verses here in Hebrews are awesome verses. Look, Jesus is able to help you through your temptations because he was tempted. The Bible also says he is our help. The Bible says he is a very present help in time of need. Is there anybody here this morning that doesn't have a need? We all have needs, don't we? Is there anybody here this morning that doesn't need help? Jesus said, I'm all those things. I was tempted. Jesus saying, I'm your help. I am your needs. I am the way. I am the truth. I am the life. And so the humanity of Jesus is very important because Jesus identifies himself with me, and he identifies himself with you. Kind of like when people that have had cancer, when they get together, they talk. If you've had chemotherapy, some of you may have had that. Anybody here that had to endure chemotherapy? Raise your hand. Anybody? I'm sure somewhere. When people that have gone through chemotherapy, they talk to other people that have gone through chemotherapy, it helps. They identify with each other. Did it make you sick? How did it make you feel? And you get comfort from talking to people that are going through the same things that you're going through. For almost 4 years now, I have suffered with an eye problem. Almost 4 years, every month, every 30 days, I have to go to the eye specialist and they give me a shot, an injection in my right eye. Almost 4 years, every month, I see my doctor, Pezda, and he tells me that if I stop getting these shots, I will go blind in my right eye. So believe me, I don't miss them. About 3 months ago or three shots ago, I was waiting for the nurse to call me in for my monthly fun time. People sometimes say, does it hurt? Of course it hurts. Did you ever stick your finger in your eye? It hurts. Yes, it does. I was sitting next to a lady who was very nervous, and I was able to share the gospel with her, and she said, who is your doctor? And I said, my doctor is Dr. Pezda. Oh, she said, he's my doctor also. And I said, well, why are you here? She said, well, they told me that I have to have a shot in my eye. And she said, I'm nervous. She said, have you ever had a shot in your eye? I said, ma'am, I've had over 35 of them. And she got a smile on her face. She said, tell me about it. And I said to her, there's nothing to it. There's nothing to it. You won't feel anything. I wasn't lying. But I wasn't really telling her the total truth. It was kind of in between. Because, yes, it does hurt a little. But I said, you know something? the doctor's going to numb your eye before he puts the needle in there, and you know, it's really not all that bad. And she looked at me and she said, thank you, I feel so much better. She identified with my problem, and it helped her. I have good news. Listen up. Jesus identifies with your problem. The person in heaven, listen carefully, you got to get this. You got to get this. If you don't get this, I'm going to be mad at you. The person in heaven, Jesus Christ, is sitting on a throne of grace today because he suffered as a human on earth to make it all possible. Think about that. Let me say it to you again. The person in heaven, Jesus, is sitting on a throne of grace today because he suffered as a human on earth to make it all possible. You see, my friends, the Bible says that Jesus took our punishment. He took our penalty. But I was thinking about that the other day, and I don't know why it never dawned on me. But Jesus did more. He did more than just take your punishment on the cross. He took your sin and your punishment. Listen to me. Jesus, who had no sin of his own, took mine. Me, who had no righteousness of my own, he gave me his. Think about that. He not only paid the penalty for your sin, he took your sin upon himself so that you could be righteous. The word righteous means right standing. So that before a holy God, you can be in right standing. The good news of the gospel is this. Before you leave this church this morning, you can trade all of your sin for the righteousness of Jesus Christ. He'll make that deal with you. He'll take all of your sin and he'll give you all of his righteousness. Ah, man, the awesomeness of Jesus, the man who was God. Now, Satan is going to try to convince you that you're the worst sinner there ever was. Oh, you're such a bad sinner, you shouldn't even be here. You shouldn't even be in this church with all these holy people. That's what Satan wants you to believe. That's what Satan wants you to think. Jesus paid it all. All to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain, but he washed me white as snow. The blood of Jesus. Now, quickly, three ways, and I'll be finished. Three ways that Jesus was tempted. Three areas in my life. Three areas in your life where Jesus experienced what we experience. Three things. Number one, Jesus understands relationships. He understands relationships. Mark chapter 6 and verse 3. The Bible says this, Mark 6:3, is not this the carpenter, the son of Mary? Now I want you to remember that, the son of Mary, because it'll come up in a minute when I finish. Is not this the carpenter, the son of Mary, the brother of James and Joseph and Judah and Simon? and are not his sisters here with us? And they were offended at him. Jesus understands relationships. He had four brothers, half-brothers. Half-brothers meaning they had the same mother, but not the same father. Joseph was not the father of Jesus. Jesus was virgin born from the Virgin Mary. But Jesus had four brothers. We know he had two sisters. He might have had more, but the Bible uses the word plural, sisters, so he must have had at least two. I know what it's like to grow up with sisters. I had no brothers, but I had three sisters. My wife, Nisa, has nine sisters and one brother. Nine sisters. Now, do you think for one moment that there were no problems? There were no problems in Jesus' family? Do you think they all got along perfectly well, never had an argument, never got angry, never got upset? Of course not. His family was like our families. I'm sure that his family was no different than ours. Four brothers and two sisters. I wonder if they ever played tricks on each other when they were growing up as kids. You know, like while they're sleeping, put duct tape on them and duct tape them to the bed. Stuff, you know, we used to do when we were kids. They all got along just perfectly. Not so. Not so. They had their times of getting mad and jealous and angry. And I'll bet you Jesus' brothers and sisters heard this a lot. Why can't you be more like Jesus? All their brothers and sisters probably heard. Mary probably said that a lot to the other brothers and sisters. Why can't you all be like Jesus? They heard that over and over and over. Jesus understands relationships. He understands family life. He understands being single. Some of you here this morning are single. You wanted to be married. You wanted to find somebody. You asked God to put somebody in your life, and the Lord didn't do that. Jesus knows what it's like to be single. He can identify with all you single people, okay? You say, well, Jesus never got married. Well, you better think about that. The Bible speaks over and over again about the bride of Christ. He has a bride. Revelation chapter 21 talks about the bride of Christ. Jesus knows what it is to be single. Jesus knows what it is to be married. Revelation 21 says the Lamb's wife. Revelation 21, okay? He understands an unfaithful spouse. Jesus has a lot of children that are unfaithful. He understands. He understands wayward children. The biggest heartache that parents have are seeing their children grow up, especially when they grow up in church. Seeing them grow up in church, and then when they turn 18, they turn their back on the church. They turn their back on Jesus. They turn their back on the Bible. And they walk away from that training and that upbringing that way. You know, Jesus understands that. He's got a lot of wayward children. It doesn't mean you're a failure if your children haven't turned out right, if they haven't turned out good. Don't beat yourself up for that. If you're a failure because of wayward children, then God's a failure also, because He's got a lot of wayward children. He understands. If you're here this morning, you're poor. Jesus understands poverty. He understands being poor. Jesus said, "Foxes have holes." Did you know Jesus was homeless? He was homeless. He probably slept in his clothes. 90% of the guys that you see on these TV preachers that talk about wealth and prosperity if you become a Christian, that's a lie of the devil. That is a false Jesus. There isn't anything in this book. There isn't anything in this book that says if you become a Christian, you're going to be rich, you're going to be wealthy. Jesus wasn't. And yet these health and wealth preachers fly around in their own jets, wear $1,000 tailor-made suits. That's not the Jesus of the Bible. Jesus was a servant. Jesus slept outside. Jesus was homeless. And if you're here this morning and you're poor, Jesus understands. He knows. His own family disowned him. Mark chapter 3. Put that scripture up if you have it. Mark chapter 3 and verse 21. Let me read real quickly. Mark chapter 3 and verse 21. A very interesting passage of scripture. The Bible says, Mark chapter 3 and verse 21, and when his friends heard of it, they went out to lay hold on him. They said, "He is beside himself." That's his own family. And then later on in verse 31, listen to this. Jesus was disowned by his own family. In verse 31, "There came then his brethren and his mother, and standing without, sent him, calling him." It's on the screen. "And the multitude sat about him, and they said unto him, Behold, thy mother and thy brethren without seek for thee. And Jesus answered them, saying, Who is my mother or my brethren? And he looked round about on them which sat about him and said, Behold, my mother and my brethren, for whosoever should do the will of God, the same is my brother and my mother." Jesus said, "That's not my family. You're my family." They said about Jesus, they said, "He's crazy. He's crazy." Jesus understands loneliness. He spent 33 and a half homesick years away from his father. Secondly, a realm that Jesus understands. Jesus understands work. And I hurry to finish. He understands work. Bible says he was a carpenter. When he was 12 years of age, he's working in his father's carpenter shop. The only thing that we really know a lot about what happened in Jesus' life is what happened in the last 3.5 years of his life. But Jesus understood work. He was a builder. I'm sure he had blisters and calluses from working. He knew what it was like to have a business. Maybe the sign at their carpenter shop said, "Joseph and Son, Carpenters." "Joseph and Son, Carpenters." Jesus said, "Come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, I'll give you rest." He understands work. He understands doing business. Are you a businessman? Do you own your own business? Jesus understands business. Jesus understands dealing with people in a business. He understands dealing with people who lie and cheat. He understands dealing with sometimes church people in business transactions where they lie and cheat. He understands. He understands work. And thirdly, Jesus understands pain. He understands pain. He understands relationships. He understands work. And he understands pain. Now, there are two areas of pain that Jesus is talking about. There are two areas of pain that we as humans experience. Isaiah chapter 53, I'm not going to take the time to turn there, but Isaiah chapter 53 and verse 3, here it is on the screen. This is emotional pain. There is emotional pain and there's physical pain, okay? And believe it or not, a lot of Christians suffer from emotional pain. It's called depression. Just a few weeks ago, a young pastor who was an associate pastor at the Harvest Bible Church in Riverside, California, a large church. They run over 10,000. Greg Laurie is a Southern Baptist pastor in Riverside, California. And his associate pastor, Brother Wilcox, had two small children, took his own life just about 3 weeks ago. People suffer from emotional pain. Jesus had emotional pain. Look at verse 3. He's despised and rejected of men. That's emotional pain. A man of sorrows and acquainted with grief, and we hid, as it were, our faces from him. He was despised, and we esteemed him not. Not only did Jesus suffer emotional pain, Jesus suffered physical pain. Remember, he was betrayed by his best friends. He was betrayed by his trusted friends. He was mocked right up until the time of his death. Even when he was on the cross, they said, he's not the king of the Jews. He said he was the king of the Jews. They mocked Jesus even the very time that he got on the cross. I was talking to some folks about this about a couple of weeks ago. I'm going to ask all of you to pray for our president, President Trump. Hated by his own party. How would you like it if every time you turned on the TV, somebody was lying about you? And that's what they're doing. By the way, folks, don't believe anything you see on CNN. Okay, I'm so sick of CNN. CNN stands for Communist News Network. CNN, Communist News Network. It's all fake news. They're liars. But every time you turn on the TV, somebody lying about you. That's what our president goes through day by day. In his 70s, gave up the life of a billionaire. He's hated, but you know what? He just keeps right on going. Just keeps right on going, okay? Jesus had emotional pain. Jesus suffered physical pain. And I'll be finished in a moment. Listen carefully. There are a lot of people in this room right now that suffer from physical pain and emotional pain. I've got good news for you. Jesus understands what you're going through. Isaiah chapter 53 and verse 5. He was wounded. Here's physical pain, okay? Isaiah 53, verse 5. He was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him. And with his stripes, we are healed. Jesus suffered more physical pain than any human being in the history of the world. I can't hardly even talk about it. Jesus, listen carefully, Jesus was beaten by three garrisons of guards before he ever got to the cross, before they ever drove the nails in his hands. He was beaten. He was beaten by the Jewish guards. He was beaten by Herod's guards. He was beaten by Pilate's guards. The Bible says they ripped the beard from his face. They tore the beard from the cheeks of our lovely Lord Jesus Christ. They ripped the skin. They just didn't pull the beard. The beard doesn't come out without the skin coming off. Now listen to me. They ripped the skin from the face of Jesus. And then they spit in his face. Nothing nastier than to spit in somebody's face. Our lovely Lord Jesus, listen. Jesus was tortured to death for you and for me. Physical pain, Jesus knew what physical pain was. He was tortured to death. I have a very close friend who we went to Bible college together. Stay with me now. I'm coming in for a landing, okay? I'm getting ready to close. We talk every week. We went to Bible college together. His name is Gary. He's 83 years old. He had 12 children. He had 6 children before we went to college. He had 6 more after college. So you guys that are in Bible college here that don't think you can make it, you can. He had 12 kids, 6 in college. We talk every week. He started 12 churches. He's retired now. He lives in Michigan. Gary Vischer, one of my Dutch buddies, my Dutch boy. He called me. He calls me or I call him. Nearly twice a week. Three weeks ago on Friday, Gary called me. Hey, Gary, how you doing, buddy? Silence. I hear a grown man weeping. He gained composure himself. I said, Gary, what's the matter, man? What's the matter, buddy? He said, Ray, this morning, 7:30 this morning, my son John, 59 years old, my son John is on vacation up in Ludington, or up in Traverse City. He said, my son John was walking to the lake with two, he has 9 children. He's trying to keep up with his dad, I guess. He got 9 kids, 8 boys and a girl. He said John was walking to the lake with 2 of his boys, and he said he fell down dead, heart attack. My son John is gone. I said, Gary, I don't know what to tell you, man. I wish I could be there and put my arms around your neck. Years ago, I preached the death of his daughter. He lost a daughter in a car wreck. You know something? Some of you have lost somebody dear to your heart. Somebody from your immediate family. I got good news for you. Jesus understands. He understands. Matthew, now listen. This is the part that's good. Matthew, Mark, and Luke. In Matthew, Mark, and Luke covers the last year of Jesus' life. Remember, Jesus had 3 years of ministry, 3.5 years of ministry, okay? And in that three years, Matthew, Mark, and Luke refer to Jesus as the son of Mary. You got to get this. Matthew, Mark, and Luke. Now, all the Gospels record the birth and the death of Christ. Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, okay? But Matthew, Mark, and Luke cover only the last year of Jesus' life, of the 3 years. Matthew, Mark, and Luke only cover the third year of Jesus, let's call it his earthly ministry. John covers the first 2 years of Jesus' ministry. That's why Matthew, Mark, and Luke are called synoptic gospels. Synoptic means similar. Matthew, Mark, and Luke have pretty much the same thing in all. But when you come to John, there's a lot more things in John than you'll find Matthew, Mark, and Luke. Have you ever noticed that? In John, you find, for example, when Jesus turned water into wine, it's not in the other Gospels. The story of Nicodemus is not in Matthew, Mark, and Luke. The story of Lazarus, when Jesus raised Lazarus from the dead, that's only found in the book of John. And the reason for that is because John is covering 2 years of Jesus' three-year ministry, okay? Where Matthew, Mark, and Luke are only covering 1 year. You got it? So when you come to John, there's all these other things. And one of the things that John speaks about are the last words. The last words of Jesus in John chapter 19. John chapter 19 and verse number 26. And to save time, I'll just tell you what they were. Jesus is hanging on the cross. The crowds are gone. Just a few people there. And Jesus, from the cross, said two things. Jesus said to his mother, "Woman, behold thy son." And then Jesus said to John, "Behold your mother." And basically what Jesus is saying on the cross is, John, take care of mama. Even in his death, he's concerned about somebody else. John, take care of mom. And the Bible says that from that day forward, Mary went home with John. John refers to Jesus as the son of Joseph. Remember, I told you to remember that? Matthew, Mark, and Luke refer to Jesus as the son of Mary. But John refers to Jesus as the son of Joseph. Now here's what happened. When Jesus said that to John, take care of Mama, and Mary went home and stayed the rest of her life with John. My question is this. If Joseph had been alive, why did Jesus tell John to take Jesus home with him? If Joseph would have been alive, Jesus would have said, Joseph, take care of Mom. Take care of my mom. But he didn't say that. He told John to do it. Now, everything I've said in this message so far, I can prove from Scripture. But what I'm going to say right now, I can't prove. And you can't disprove it. Jesus, history tells us that Joseph died in the third year of Jesus' ministry. In the third year. If Jesus wanted to, listen carefully, if Jesus wanted to, he could have raised Lazarus. He could have raised Joseph from the dead. But he didn't. He didn't. Because being our great high priest, Jesus wanted to experience the pain of losing someone very close to him. He cares. He wanted to feel what Gary felt, my buddy. Jesus lost Joseph, and he didn't raise him from the dead because he wanted to feel what we feel when we lay aside our precious loved ones. I said all that to say this. Jesus Christ is the answer for any problem you have. Jesus Christ is your answer this morning. He will forgive you. He will cleanse you. He can heal you. He will encourage you when you're lonely, when you're poor. Whatever it is that you need, Jesus Christ is the answer. And look, it all begins when you ask him to come into your heart and you accept him as your personal Savior. And you have a personal relationship with Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Heads bowed, eyes closed. Let's stand together. Everyone standing. Dr. DeSalva will come and close the service. I'm saying to you, bottom line, Jesus, the man who was God, and he will be your God if you'll give him a chance.
While you're standing this morning, I want you to look carefully. Look carefully. Look carefully with your mind. If you are here today and you need peace in your heart, you need forgiveness, you need the comfort that anyone can have when you are forgiven. Maybe you're here, the pastor, I have a problem in my heart. Please pray for me. How many of you will say this morning, Pastor, here is my hand. Please include me in prayer. I want Jesus to forgive me of all my sins. Would you raise your hand? I'm going to pray for you. Is there anybody like that? Is there anybody? Yes, one. We have here. We have two, three. Where else? Four, five, six. Where else? Seven right there. Anybody else? Eight. Anybody else? Come on. Raise your hand. I'm going to pray for you. Yes, right there. Nine. God bless you. Anybody else in the mezzanine? In the balcony, raise your hand. We have nine in the main floor. Anybody else in the balcony, raise your hand. Pastor, I want you to pray for me. I want Jesus to give me peace, forgiveness of my sin. Is there anybody like that? Anybody? Nine. We have 10 right there. Anybody else? Anybody else? I would like, before I pray, I'm going to pray for you. Those of you who have raised your hand, push over to the aisle and walk to the front. I will pray for you right now. Come on. Just come forward. All of you to raise your hand. Just bring them here. Bring them here. We are going to pray. And then after that, we are going to, I would ask the choir to sing an invitation song. Come right now. Yes, God bless you. God bless you. God bless you. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Anybody else? 8, 9, and 10, 11, 12, 13, 14. Anybody else? Anybody else? 15 right there. Brother Marlon right there behind you. Right there. 14. Anybody else before I pray? 15.